highly in our eyes. We would respect him. He would be someone honored in our eyes. This man has memorized Baqarah and Ali Imran. We would revere this person. He would be honored by our side. And the reason is because this is not someone that has just memorized Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran. This is someone that has memorized these two surah and that knows every single ruling that is within those two great chapters of the Quran. And they're the longest. And there are so many verses of ahkam, rulings, legislations in those two chapters. So one that memorized Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran has memorized every single ruling in that, in those two chapters. وَقَامَ إِبْنُ عُمَرَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ Abdullah ibn Umar, for example, it took him a number of years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. قِيلَ ثَمَانِ سَنَوَاتِ Some would say 8 years, some 12, some 10. At least 8 years, it took him 8 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. And today it takes us, maybe a child or any of us, it would take us less than a year, less than 6 months even to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Al-Baqarah has 200 odd verses. If you were to memorize one verse each day, it wouldn't take you a year, right? So Abdullah ibn Umar, it took him 8 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. So we understand that their memorizing of the Quran was different to our memorizing. Their memorizing of the Quran included the understanding of these verses. And that's why it's mentioned that Abdullah ibn Umar, when he would memorize, when he finished the memorization of Surah Al-Baqarah, he put a feast and he invited many people. And he made a feast in his house because of the fact that he had memorized Surah Al-Baqarah. So the point is that the objective of this Quran is its understanding and what it means. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it and sent it down. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted from us that we understand and we implement this Quran. And that we do not just recite it without understanding its And that's why it's far better for someone to recite the Quran with understanding, to recite half of the Quran whilst contemplating over its verses, than one to recite the Quran 20 times without contemplating its verses. Yes, there's ajr in reciting the Quran. And we know that the Prophet ﷺ said, with every letter that you recite, you get 10 ajr. وَلَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ And the Prophet ﷺ would say, I don't say alif la meem is a harf, لكن alif harf, ulam harf, wa meem harf. So the recitation of it, there is ajr involved with it. لكن what is far better than that is to recite it and to contemplate over its verses as the companions would do. And so this was in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the manner in which they would memorize and learn this Quran. And Abdullah ibn Abbas was gifted by the Prophet ﷺ that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the understanding of this Quran. And the Prophet ﷺ would make dua for him and would say, Allahumma allimhu ta'wil, Allahumma allimhu al-Quran wa faqihu fi ta'wil. Around those lines, the exact dua that the Prophet ﷺ made was, oh Allah, teach him the Quran and make him understand it. And so Abdullah ibn Abbas, and we know that the dua of the Prophet ﷺ is accepted. His dua and he is accepted. So Abdullah ibn Abbas was Turjuman al-Quran. He's referred to as by the companions. This laqab and this title was given to him by the companions. Turjuman al-Quran, I mean the translator of the Quran. And if there was any dispute as to what a verse means, they would go back to Abdullah ibn Abbas. And from his students was a man called Mujahid ibn Jabr. And Mujahid ibn Jabr, he would say, عَرَّضْتُ الْمُصْحَفَ عَلَى ابْنِ عَبَّاسٍ I presented the Mus'haf, the Qur'an, to Abdullah ibn Abbas. أُوقِفُهُ عِنْدَ كُلِّ آيَةٍ And I would stop him at every single verse, وَأَسْأَلُهُ عَنْهَا And I would ask him about it. So I would recite, for example, to Abdullah ibn Abbas, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, I'll say, oh, Abdullah, what does it mean? And he would explain it to me. When did it come down? He would explain to me when it came down. Where did it come down? It came down there. And then he would say, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Oh, Abdullah, what does it mean? This is what it means. Where did it come down? It came down here. Every single verse of the Quran, Mujahid ibn Jabr, he presented it to Abdullah ibn Abbas and he stopped him, paused him at every single verse, asking him what it means, where it came down, and asking him everything about that verse. And he completed the whole Mus'haf, the whole Quran like that, upon Abdullah ibn Abbas. And that's why when you look back at the books of Tafsir, like Ibn Kathir and Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, or any book of Tafsir that you pick up, you will always see them taking the statements of Mujahid. You will say, Mujahid said this regarding this verse, and Mujahid said so regarding this verse, and Mujahid said so. Why? Because he was the one that, and he presented the whole Mus'haf to Abdullah ibn Abbas. And al-Bukhari, in his Sahih al-Bukhari, he has a chapter, Kitab al-Tafsir, right? The book of Tafsir. Why he brings verses of the Quran, many verses of the Quran, and he brings any narrations, a hadith, or any understanding regarding that verse, he brings it under that heading, and the majority of it are statements of Mujahid ibn Jabr. So, the Tabi'een are the second generation after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and again, this is the manner in which they learnt the Quran from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whereby they would refer to the back to the Sahaba. Now the tafsir is of two types, as I mentioned before. One type is tafsir manquli, which is a tafsir of, and it we accept it the way it is. Manqul is nuqila ilayna, it was conveyed to us in that manner. And tafsir ma'qul, and a tafsir that has understanding in it. Tafsir ma'qul is, for example, the verses that speak about Bani Israel, or the stories of the prophets. We take it as it is. Musa alayhi salam, these are verses that spoke about a time in history that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is narrating to us. So we take it as it is. Yani there is no hidden understanding behind these verses. These are qisas that we take as it is, right? And those that reach those times, they will have the, were aware of these events that took place. And those that didn't, didn't. One of the credits that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had, that when he claimed, or when he, I wouldn't say claim, like when he said that he was a prophet and the disbelievers didn't believe him, one of the things that stopped them from rejecting his message was the qisas of the Quran. Where did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam get these stories from? Musa alayhi salam, and detailed stories of Musa alayhi salam. They knew that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not one that could read or write, so they knew he could not have read it from previous scripts, from the books of the Bible or the books of the people before us, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never could read. He wasn't someone that could read, nor was he someone that could write. So one credit that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had was that these verses speaking about Musa alayhi salam and other prophets, they were mentioned in those other books. وَقَالُوا أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ اكْتَتَبَهَا فَهِيَ تُمْنَى عَلَيْهِ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. What would the disbelievers say? أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ, tales from the past. اكْتَتَبَهَا, he wrote it, or he ordered for it to be written. فَهِيَ تُمْنَى عَلَيْهِ, and it is recited upon him. بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا, day and night. Meaning he's made to memorize it. People go out, they write these tales, they come to the Prophet ﷺ and they make him memorize it. Then he comes out in the open and he says, this is what happened with Musa, this is what happened with Yusuf alayhi salam, Yunus, all of these prophets. And there's a beautiful event when the Prophet ﷺ went to a Taif. He went to present himself. And on his way back from a Taif, he met, only when he came back from a Taif, he was literally fleeing a Taif, and the men of a Taif were throwing him with pebbles and stones. So the Prophet ﷺ was running away and he was bleeding with his feet. So the Prophet ﷺ, he went underneath a small opening into a garden. So when he's in this garden, there's a young boy, a servant who worked in the garden. His name was Adas. So this servant, he felt sorry for the Prophet. He doesn't know who this man is. He doesn't know, like all he sees is a man running away who's bleeding and his feet are full of blood. So Adas, he brings some dates and some water. He feels sorry for the Prophet. So the Prophet he asks him, "What's your name?" And his name, this man says, or this young boy, he says, "My name is Adas." And he asks him, "Where are you from?" And this young boy says, "I'm from an area in Al-Iraq, nowadays Iraq." And he had a name. And so the Prophet says, "That is where my brother Yunus ibn Matta is from." Meaning, Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, that is where he's from. So this young boy is perplexed, amazed. And he says, "Subhanallah, I have always heard my parents, my uncles, my family members speak about Yunus ibn Matta. And I've always heard them speak about the fact that we are from the land of Prophet Yunus. When I migrated to these lands, Mecca and Al-Taif, no one knows about Yunus. No one heard about it. Yani it is a story that is with our family members. Like no one knows about it. How do you know about it? Well, who told you about Yunus ibn Matta?" And the Prophet said, "Allah told me I'm a prophet." And this man, he embraced Islam because of this. So the stories of the Quran, yani, they put credit and they affirm and confirm the prophethood of the Prophet. So this young man says, yani, Yunus ibn Matta, he is from our area, but no one knows about him. How do you know about it? And the way the Prophet knew about it was that he was a prophet. So these are verses that are called as verses that were conveyed to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We take it as it is. And then we have verses that may be interpreted. And these are called tafsir ma'quli. And if their interpretation is in accordance, if the Prophet mentioned them, we take it as it is. And if their interpretation is far-fetched, then we reject it. Some interpretations are very far-fetched. So we reject them. And they have no, their interpretation are even far away from understanding. An example of that is the Shia, for example, the Rawafid, when they say, "Maraj al-Bahrayn yaltaqiyan, baynahuma barzakhun la yabghiyan." Maraj al-Bahrayn yaltaqiyan, the two seas when they meet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about these two seas that meet. Maraj al-Bahrayn yaltaqiyan, when Allah says, these two seas, baynahuma barzakhun, between them is a barrier that they never mix. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about the seas and the rivers that meet, the oceans and the seas that meet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking about the fact that they never mix up. Here you have the ocean that is, the water is what? Salty water, right? And the rivers, they are sweet water. You can drink river water, whereas you can't drink seawater. Seawater is salty and river water is sweet, and they meet. Any river, it streams into a sea. Never do the two mix. It's from the miracles of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That these two seas, يَخْرُجُ مِنْهُمَا اللُّؤْلُؤُ وَالْمَرْجَانُ. Allah says, and from them you take out pearls. And you beautify yourself with it. وَمَا يَسْتَوِ الْبَحْرَانِ. Allah says, these two seas are not the same. هَذَا عَذْبٌ فُرَاتٌ سَائِغٌ شَرَابٌ وَهَذَا مِلْحٌ أُجَاجٌ وَمِنْ كُلٍ تَأْكُلُونَ لَحْمًا طَرِيًّا. The two seas are not the same, meaning the rivers and the oceans. هَذَا عَذْبٌ فُرَاتٌ. This is sweet, you can drink from it, the river. وَهَذَا مِلْحٌ أُجَاجٌ. And this is salty. وَمِنْ كُلٍّ تَأْكُلُونَ لَحْمًا طَرِيًّا. However, from both of these seas, the rivers and the oceans, you eat meat. You fish and you eat the fish from it. Miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fish from it, you eat them. Eat them. They're good to eat. The water, you can't drink them. Especially the salty water. The sweet water, you can drink it. And these two seas never meet. So this is a miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what do the Shia and the Rawafid, they say? For example, they say, مَرَجْ الْبَحْرَيْنِ يَلْتَقِيَانِ. These two seas, they meet. It means Ali and Fatima. Ali ibn Abi Talib and Fatima, the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yakhruju minhuma, from it comes, Allah says, pearls, lu'lu' wal marjan. And they say, from it came Hassan and Hussein. Now this is a very far-fetched yani understanding of the Quran. Never did the if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us this is what it means, then we would have taken it. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say it. It does not go in accordance with the language. So such tafsir is rejected. And then there is tafsir that is ma'qul, interpretation that may be accepted if it goes in accordance with the understanding. Like for example, today we have various with many, and we've reached knowledge that in the time of the Prophet they may not have reached. For example, today they're able to prove that the earth is round and that the earth is not flat. When in back in those days they used to believe that the earth is flat. So the earth is round. Likewise, the embryo, the stages of the embryo that the womb goes through, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ يَكُونُ نُطْفَةً بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ, it becomes a piece of flesh, then it forms. So all these are verses, and in the time of the Prophet, they will take it as it is. Never will they be able to interpret it, except that the way it is. Now we've reached a new science where we are able to uncover certain hidden knowledge that we may not have been able to do so before. So for example, وَالْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ دَحَاهَا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and the earth after it, Allah says dahaha. Now daha, there is a difference of opinion what it means. So nowadays some would say it means after we created the earth, we made it round. وَالْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ دَحَاهَا. Some would say no, look at the other verses after it. أَخْرَجَ مِنْهَا مَاءَهَا وَمَرْعَاهَا. أخرج منها, he caused from it to come, ماءها is water and its springs, يعني that gush, ومرعاها, so that is a tafsir. Another tafsir, someone would say, no, it means Allah made it round after that. This is a tafsir that we say, الله أعلم, Allah knows best, whether it is correct, may be correct, the language doesn't deny it, nor does the understanding of what we have today. Allah knows whether it is correct, though, we don't know. So this is called a tafsir which is ma'qul, and it's called a tafsir that uses ijtihad if you want, or it uses diligence. So, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left that tafsir like it is. Why? Because the Quran was there to be contemplated, for you to contemplate and understand this Quran, and to take from it new understandings that are in accordance with Islam, that are in accordance with the understanding. A tafsir is definitely wrong if it goes completely against the opinions of the companions. Why? Because we believe that the companions understood the Quran better than all of us, as the Quran came down to them. It is like, for example, a news article that you read today and it says, due to the events of coronavirus, Boris Johnson has resigned. That is the article. If you were to give that same article 200 years down the line, no one would understand the why did he resign? So what? But you are able to make sense that, okay, because he was incompetent when it came to handling coronavirus. I'm just giving an example, by the way. And so you understand the background information of this resignation. Whereas 200 years down the line, they won't understand this background information that you had. You lived the moment. They didn't live the moment. The companions lived the moment. The Quran, when it came down to the Prophet ﷺ, they understood why it came down, where it came down, why Allah revealed it. So, whereas we have not lived that moment, we can study it and we can try and bring that gap of living that moment closer. Like we don't live the moment. And that's why one of the reasons it is good to study history is because it makes you live in another life. When you study, for example, the biography of the Prophet ﷺ and the history of the companions, It is as if you lived the two lives. Your life, you've lived it. You live the moment. And if you study the details of the biography of the Prophet ﷺ, you study the tribal system, the way they live, everything in detail, you've lived that life as well. And so you're able to contemplate and understand certain verses that came down, when they came down at that time, because of your understanding of the moments. So that is yani another benefit or a benefit of studying the history or the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah, we'll stop there and we'll continue with it next week. Or we may take off next week because of Eid. But like we'll continue with the week after. Inshallah, we'll just have a khairan. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.